power of the Holy Spirit makes us the body of Christ. Today we'll hear a couple of stories about God's grace unfolding. Stories that take a bit of a turn. Turns out we like them. So we come to give God our lives, that God might work one of those miraculous turns for each of us. With open hearts, we worship together. So it's actually a holy thing for us, and a welcome thing, to hear God speak to us from the other side. And we are blessed because we have people who can speak to us. So I'd like for Nikki to come speak to us and tell us a little something about how we connect with some of those other folks.
Hi, everybody. I'm so happy to be here and to be part of you. In May, a lot of us gathered for two different days to much begin my journey. A journey that I never shared with you, but most of you now have heard. What is it behind resentment, parents? I think a lot of people think about it. Why is Nikki doing this? I'm doing this because it's a reflection of me. Those kids you guys are helping is actually me. That's how I grew up. I didn't grow up in a fancy house. I grew up in a rural setting, no lights. I used to study the flame, the fire. And I know how it is. That's why I always try to move back. So when you guys made those, you didn't know it's a life changer. These girls were in tears when they got home. They couldn't believe it. Actually, just go back a little bit. Me and my husband went, but we went on different days. And when we got there, he called me and said, "Nikki, don't you ever bring me just one space." I'm like, "Why?" He said, "I was at the airport for 5 hours. He had 2 suitcases, but he didn't understand the case." He said, "I had to pay them for them to release me. They were going through, oh, you have 4 shirts, well, what is the 50 shirt for? You have 2 pairs of shoes, what is it?" They went through everything just to frustrate you until you release some money. But anyways, I was like, "Oh, okay, please don't," I'm like, "I'm not doing it." I took all my bicycles and then I left. As soon as I got to the airport, I mean, they would, especially when they know that this plane is connecting from the United States or from London, they get all fired up because they don't want, they want to collect some money. So eventually, as soon as I landed with my bicycle, everybody's looking. One young man who just stopped here just approached me. "Do you really want to drop?" I'm like, "What do you mean by that?" He said, "Yeah, they have so much money." I'm like, "Yeah, but they're all gifts, they don't care." I'm like, "So what do I need to do? Give it to me." I'm like, "Okay, go ahead." It took me 5 minutes for a $20 pay, which was made up, but I did. and I got through. So, when my first visit was Govan Saturday, I think some of you, I've been helping these kids for quite a long time. I involved the chiefs, I involved the leaders. The main reason why I involved all these people was to make this topic comfortable, because it's a taboo to talk about menstruation in my country. You get into this phase of life with trial and error. Nobody even teaches you. You have to ask friends how to do it. And worse still, they have no resources. From first grade to fifth grade, the girls are shining, they are all on top of the class, but by the time they hit that phase, they just go down. And nobody asked what's going on. So I did involve them. They were very uncomfortable. The kids were very uncomfortable because it's a topic that cannot be discussed when men are there. But I explained my reason why. I told him, why do you think your girl is not naked? If you ever ask yourself that, why is my girl, or she was first in the first or second week? And if you ever thought of doing some statistics of other countries, like where I come from now, where the girls really maintain their education level the same way, they didn't have an answer. So I told them I don't have to answer it myself because I'm the girl, I'm that girl who is sitting on the ground. I'm that girl who was never looked at. I'm that girl, nobody asked why I was sad or why I was in school. So this is what happens during that period of time, 5 days. When you don't have anything, you'd rather stay home. Who wants to be married? So you are losing all that education. You have to lie that you're sick. You don't even participate in sport because you know what it is. So I did explain and I told them, see, that's the first time. And I mean, I'm out of that country because of trouble, because I always try to speak up. But I told them, I'm going to speak up for the girls because the girls go through a lot in this country. We're only the village. There's a lot of things that are called taboos just to be interested in male partner. Girls are being used as maids. You have 3 girls and 3 boys, and boys never do the chores that we all do here. From school, you're expected to do dishes, you're expected to walk 2 miles to go get some water, and you have these pieces again, menstruation, and nobody cares. So I told them that my first visit, we used a disposable sanitary pad, and I really didn't see a reason why we should continue that, because one, it's expensive, two, you use it once and that's it. And I explained how my church came together and brought all these ideas together, and that was the best we ever did. They were so happy. It's just unfortunate that one school is like about 210 girls, and the other high school is about 205. Together, they're about 415. So we only had like 150 roughly. So we chose the girls who were participating in sports, and we demonstrated in front of the kids how to put it on with an underwear. They were all like that. I'm like, yeah, this is how we do it. So I also demonstrated how to wash them, soak it overnight, wash it and use the other one. And they were so amazed with the thought of bringing in insect pins. They're like, well, these people are so much good, because we even thought of the problem in case they were, of course they were big. These girls are, I think you'll see that the size they show up, their size, they're not as big because they walk a lot. If they have 2 meals, that's good enough. So they are quite slender. Then the second school I went to, I was not able to go with the chief because the chief was to go to other meetings, or maybe it was just an excuse because I was just meeting the mayor. So on the second one, it was just so painful that I also tried to empower them to say, you know what, girls, you can do it. I was in that situation, or even worse. But look at me now. You just have to hold on. You just have to treat your body as the God's temple. Don't let anyone abuse you. That's when I went wrong, because there's this girl who approached me after. Yeah, I wouldn't say it's wrong because she has able to speak to me. She told me that you spoke about abuse. I have spoken to my teachers. My brother abuses me every week. And like my sister, he's been beating me, I have scars. He beats me from the where I cover, and I've shown my teacher that. They have tried to interfere with it, but it appears nothing is helping. Both the parents are out of the country trying to support their family. They're in South Africa right now. They work with nannies and garden boy to try to help them out because of our situation in Zimbabwe. I was so down all day. I'm like, so what happens? Oh, nothing. I know this Friday, this coming, is going to be easy. Simply, a brother, not just a brother, no, nothing, a brother. So I felt like I did not help. The child was so helpless and hopeless. And he's from the teacher's perspective, he said, if I try to teach more, I don't even know what to put to that kid. They live in our school settings are like they will build a school like this, and they will build teachers' houses around. And you are a stranger in that village. The only people you know is the students. So she is trying her best, and she felt like she had no more resources to help. I was like, oh, what do I do? You know, I felt I'm buying tickets in thousands right now in trying to, at least if I could afford maybe to go to the school, get all those abused kids. Like, you get so overwhelmed. Like, you. I just been crying. That's all. I should be crying. Because. Then the boys felt I was neglecting them when I was going to my car. The boy came, why do you always come here and you see the girls? Don't you mean that? I'm like, no, tomorrow I have no plans. Tomorrow I'm not going to come to see the boys. So I went, soccer is considered a male sport. So I went to see them play. They were so happy. I think I have some pictures as well. They were so happy that I was there. I had no plans for them, but they were just doing them. They're doing good. They don't even have shoes to. I mean, not even just shoes, uniforms. What they do, you know how you are there and on the other side. The uniform is the other party takes the shirts off. And that's it, they're playing. Happy. And I'm like, wow. You know, so I did take pictures, and I promised that I was going to look for maybe old uniforms, doesn't matter the colors, and at least they will save their school uniforms, because every child puts on a school uniform just to every child in the same level. So I also made that empty promise that I was going to look for soccer uniforms. So if anybody knows a school that is throwing out soccer uniforms, they can grow up with me. Good. So I talk a lot, he knows, so so I will end up here, but the plan is to go back in December. And I was talking to one of the members here that my wish is to not to continue making this sanitary pad, is to get the patterns and get the fabric, and get machines made within sharing between those two schools, and maybe I'll spend 1 week teaching how to make a sanitary pad. I think that would be a solution to this problem that we have in my place. May God bless you. I love you all.
Siblings in Christ, whatever happens, God will turn into grace. Listen to the stories of those whom you're tempted to walk past. You hear the voice of God. Go in peace. Serve God with joy.